Just to drive it home, though, exactly what your neural network is, you know, quote unquote, seeing, let's go ahead and visualize what that looks like. So what this image is showing is the first 500 training samples flattened out in the same format that your neural network's going to get it. So this is stretching out over 784 numerical values for each value. So from 0 to 500, we have each individual input image flattened out into a 1D array of 784 values. So instead of constructing this as individual 2D images, which is how your brain might process it, instead we're going to create a neural network that actually tries to recognize patterns in these flattened rows instead. And we're just going to go through the first 500 here, reshape them to the 1D format that we're actually going to be feeding into our neural network, concatenate those all into a single image and display that. So you can see here we have sort of these bands that correspond to the center of the image on each row. And it's a little bit mind-blowing here. I think it's important to realize that this is the raw input into the neural network that we're going to build. So each row, this represents a training sample being fed into our neural network as we train it. And what that neural network is quote unquote seeing is just one row of that data at a time. So, you know, your brain would have a very hard time trying to figure out, well, does this particular row represent the number 2 or not? There's no way in heck you're going to figure that out just by looking at it. But we're going to create our own little special neural network that actually does that. And, you know, later on we'll talk about how to actually do real image processing better in a way that's closer to how your brain actually processes things. But I think it's remarkable that this works at all using this sort of naive approach. All right, let's actually start writing some code to put it all together and build our graph in TensorFlow. First thing we need to do is create some placeholders for the input training data and the target labels. So we will set up a placeholder called input_images of shape none 784. So what that means is that we're going to create a placeholder for the training data, or the data being input into our neural network, that has some arbitrary number of input values, input images, and each one of those images will contain 784 values. So that just defines the shape of the data that's going into our neural network. We also need to create a placeholder for the target labels, and that will have a shape of some arbitrary number of target images and a one-hot array of 10 values that we use to evaluate the actual labels. So the point of doing a placeholder here is that we can reuse this same neural network for training and for testing and for actually using it in practice. So for our first pass where we're training our neural network, our input images will be assigned to our training dataset images. The target labels placeholder will be assigned to the labels of that training data set, and we will use that to actually run gradient descent and actually try to tune the weights between each neuron. Later on, when we're testing the performance of this neural network, our input images will be assigned to the images in our test data set. The target labels will be assigned to the known labels of those testing data set images, and then we can measure how well our neural network predicted the correct label versus that target label set. And if you were going to actually use this in the real world, you wouldn't be using the target labels at all. You would just assign the input images to the images that you want to classify and look at the output in target labels and see what you came up with. Moving on, we still need to run this stuff, by the way. Let's go ahead and execute that image there and see if that actually works. And in this block, we'll go ahead and set up those placeholders. Just select that block, hit Shift Enter, and that should be all set up. Now again, nothing really happens in TensorFlow until we actually evaluate things and actually execute things. We're just sort of setting up the graph at this point. So let's go ahead and set up the topology of our neural network itself. We're going to set up a multi-layer perceptron here. We'll start off with 784 input images. So what this first line is saying is we're going to create a tensor called input_weights. That's going to be a variable that is normalized 784, hidden nodes. So that means that we're going to create a layer here that has 784 input signals. That's one for each input pixel of each image. And it's going to have an output of 512 hidden nodes going to the next layer. Okay, so this is setting up a layer of our neural network that takes 784 inputs and has outputs going to 512 inputs to the next layer. Okay, we also need to set up the input biases, which is just going to be a 1D array of the 512 hidden nodes in between. So this is going to be the bias terms on that layer between the input layer and the hidden layer. Okay. Now again, in TensorFlow, we kind of have to do this all the hard way. We're just describing things in terms of linear algebra here. So we're just going to have these matrices of weights and vectors of biases that we're passing around. For the hidden layer itself, we're going to have an input of 512 and an output of 10 going to our final classification layer in one hot format. And we will also have a bias vector applied to that as well. That is 10 wide. That will be applied to the final output layer. Okay, Next, let's go ahead and hit Shift Enter to get that set up. Next, we need to put it all together. So we're going to create an input layer that does a matrix multiplication between that input image layer and the input weights that we set up as a variable. So again, remember these input weights are a variable that will contain those weights and over time, you know, tweak them. So it maintains memory between each training run. We will then define our hidden layer as using the ReLU activation function on the sum of that input layer's matrix multiplication and the bias vector that we set up previously, okay? Finally, we'll compute our output layer as doing a matrix multiplication between that hidden layer's output and the weight matrix of those hidden layer, and add in that hidden bias vector of 10 as well, okay? So just to explain better the difference between what's in this block and what's in this block, let's go ahead and hit Shift Enter before we forget to actually set that up. What we're doing up here is creating variables to hold the weights and biases between each training run, okay? So these are maintaining the memory of the actual weights and bias terms within our neural network from run to run. What we're doing in this block is actually defining the connections, defining the layers themselves. So we're saying here that we're going to have our input layer that uses that variable that we created to for all the weights of the input values. We'll create a hidden layer that also uses the output of that input layer and the bias variables that we assign for that. We will also use the hidden weights and hidden biases variables as we define our final digit weights layer here that ultimately goes to our final classification step, okay? Whew. Again, it's a lot to wrap your head around, but we're doing it the hard way. Remember, this is going to get easier, I promise. So again, what we've done is set up a very simple multi-layer perceptron with an input layer of 784 inputs, one for each pixel of each image. There is a hidden layer of 512 neurons that goes to an output layer of 10, which represents one hot format of the final classification. All right, next thing we need to do is set up a loss function. How do we actually measure the correctness of our results? And the way we're going to do that is by using softmax, which we talked before. So we're going to use specifically softmax with something called cross-entropy. All that does is apply a logarithmic scale to penalize incorrect classifications more than ones that are close. So that's just a way of making things converge a little bit more quickly. We will assign the final output layer of our digit weights and use the target labels as what are the so-called correct answers that we want to converge toward. Okay, so we've created a loss function that takes a look at our final digit weights, applies softmax to them, and compares that to the target labels in one hot format. Okay, so that's what we're going to be optimizing for. Shift Enter. Next, we need to define an optimizer that will apply to this neural network, and we're going to just use a straight up gradient descent optimizer. The 0.5 is the learning rate. That's something you can play with if you want to. Obviously, if it's too big, you might overshoot the actual minimum that you're looking for. If it's too small, it might take too long, and we will assign it that loss function that we just defined to actually descend upon. Shift Enter. Finally, we need to create a function that measures the accuracy of our resulting neural network. So we will set up a function called correct prediction. And actually, this is another graph in TensorFlow that we're setting up that will just evaluate whether the argmax of the final digit weights matches the argmax of the target labels. So if the largest final weight output of our neural network matches the largest one hot format of our target labels, that will give it a one value, otherwise a zero. And we will measure accuracy by taking the mean of all of those correct prediction results over all of the training data of all the test data that we actually measured. So Shift Enter. All right, let's actually run this thing. So all we've done up to this point is define the actual graph within TensorFlow that we're going to run. Let's go ahead and run the global variables initializer to get those initial values into it. What we're going to do now is run 2,000 training steps of 100 images on each batch, okay? So for x in range 2,000, that means that we're going to execute the following block of code 2,000 times. We will pick out the next 100 training images from our batch of training images. We will run our optimizer, so this is what actually kicks off TensorFlow and actually does some real work. And we pass in this dictionary in Python that just matches placeholders to actual data. So for this training run, we're going to assign a batch of 100 training images to the input images placeholder, and we will take the labels data in one hot format and assign that to the target labels placeholder and let that run and be optimized. And then finally here, for every 100 steps, we'll print out what epoch we're currently on and the accuracy that we've seen. This will just let us see the progress over time, because since we didn't install the GPU accelerated version of TensorFlow, this can actually take a while. So let's go ahead and hit Shift M. Mistake. So let's go ahead and hit Shift Enter and kick this off. It's actually running pretty quickly. And you can see how that accuracy is getting better and better over time. Although at this point, you know, we probably could have done early stopping, because at around 92%, it's really not going to do much better. Okay, so there we have it. All right, so hey, that's not bad, but we got about 92% accuracy in correctly predicting the correct classification of a bunch of images out of the MNIST dataset. So that's kind of cool. So let's actually take a look at our test data and evaluate the performance of this thing for real. What we're going to do is go through the first 100 test images and just print out any ones that are actually incorrectly classified, so we can get a more intuitive feel of the sorts of images that our neural network is having trouble with. So we're going to go through the first 100 images, take each one. The image will be flattened to a 784 wide array of pixels, which is what our neural network expects as input. We'll also pluck out the labels as well, convert that to a human readable label using the argmax function. We will then run, using the same session that we've been using before, our neural network, using the input images of X-train that we extracted from the test data set, and actually get the argmax result of that classification. So basically this is going through one image at a time and feeding it into our neural network and seeing if it actually matches the predicted label or not. So we'll take our prediction that comes out of the neural network here, compare that to the label that we know is the one that was correct for this image, and if it does not match, we'll print out the actual picture of the one that it got wrong. So let's run that. Interesting. So for example, here is somebody who was trying to draw the number 9 and made this thing that our system thought was a 7. Not exactly the best handwriting there. You can kind of understand how it got confused. Here's a, I guess that was supposed to be a 5. We thought it was a 6, which is really not unreasonable. This is someone trying to draw the number 2. For some reason, we thought it was a 3. It's a very messy 2. Here's someone trying to draw an 8 that we thought was a 2, and this is an example of where, you know, your human brain probably wouldn't have much of a trouble with that. But, you know, the fact that we're just trying to create a very limited neural network here that only deals with these things in a 1D fashion means that we're kind of limited in the effectiveness here. Later on, we'll talk about more techniques that can do this more efficiently, but for now, you know, it's not too bad. Anyway, some more examples here that you can look at. You can see that that's pretty clearly a 4 to me, but for some reason we thought it was a 9. So this 1D approach to learning has its limitations, but overall, it's not bad. We actually constructed a neural network that can classify the correct number that someone was trying to draw more often than not. So, hey, that's kind of cool. Anyway, let's see if you can improve upon it as an exercise. If you want to fiddle around with things, try using more hidden neurons. Try using fewer. What's the least amount that you can use before quality starts to suffer? Try adding another hidden layer. Try different batch sizes. Just mess around with things. Get your hands dirty. See if you can do a better job. Well, let's see what the best accuracy you can get from this multi-layer perceptron. Can you actually top my results? Have some fun with it. And in our next lecture, we'll talk about how to make this all a lot easier using the Keras library.